Soothing story time. The Yeti and the Strange Cave, Part 7. When the Yeti popped his head over the edge of the rock to see into the next cave above, he found it was a pine forest, a small pine forest in a cave. The pines were 3 or 4 times taller than him, and small flowers that grew underneath glowed blue, lighting up the forest from below. There were a few glowing yellow butterflies that flitted about the tops of the trees, lighting them from above. He wasn't sure where Great Aunt Honey was, but he could hear a rustling. Meow. The rustling stopped. Meow, 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 meow. She was up a tree, looking for honey. A butterfly flew close to him, looked at him in a confused way, and flew off again, up to another butterfly. The two butterflies hovered in the air next to each other, then turned to look at him. The Yeti waved. The butterflies stared at him for a while. Then they each flapped their right wing faster, then turned and flitted off into the trees. The Yeti felt that he had made friends. He'd never made friends with butterflies before. They had always been uninterested in his smiling and talking to them, and gone about their business, ignoring him. Great Aunt Honey fell out of a tree, squashed some glowing blue flowers, sat up, got up, and scrambled up a different tree. The Yeti ambled over to the blue flowers, bent down and sniffed them. He got pollen on his nose. The pollen glowed too. The scent was sharp, like freshly cut lemon. But the Yeti had never seen a lemon. The Yeti sniffed some more. He wondered if the flowers were safe to eat. He didn't want to fall asleep again. He plucked a petal and tried it. It tasted like unripe lemons. The Yeti spat it out and pulled a face. Great Aunt Honey snapped a branch off by accident and fell out of a tree again. She tried a different tree instead. The Yeti wondered how many of the blue flowers she would squash by the time she was finished. The Yeti went rummaging around in the trees, looking for the magic sandwich. He assumed whatever it was would look magic. He peered round every trunk and moved the branches aside to look up into every tree. Great Aunt honey, hadn't found any honey at all, and was disappointed. She did have a butterfly sitting on her bald ear, though. The Yeti climbed up a tree to get a good view of the tops of the trees and check for magic sandwiches hidden in the alcoves. When he got to the top of the tree, he leaned on it and snapped it off. He carefully hid it so no one would notice. The treetops looked normal, apart from they were in a cave. Great Aunt Honey popped up in a tree nearby. Peekaboo! She disappeared again. The Yeti dropped down and tried to find his great aunt in the thick undergrowth of the pines. Peekaboo! She popped up behind him, then disappeared again. They played peekaboo for a while. The Yeti didn't manage to sneak up on his great aunt. She was champion sneaky Yeti of the whole region. The Yeti was the worst at sneaking about. He got lost, forgot what he was doing, and wandered off to find somewhere comfy to nap. After they were bored of peekaboo, they tried eating some pine needles. It was a nice snack, but they wanted a big dinner. They got up and went to see where the spiral staircase would lead them to next. Great Aunt Honey rushed ahead. The Yeti followed at a leisurely pace. His great aunt was standing on the stairs, looking out into the cave, with her head on one side. She moved her head to the other side. The Yeti came up the stairs and peered over the edge into the room. It was full of floating beards. They bobbed about gently, these beards, floating halfway between the floor and the ceiling. The Yeti and his great aunt looked at each other. She raised her fluffy eyebrow. He shrugged. The beards didn't react. Nothing. They just floated like pondweed. The Yeti tried, which was Yeti for, "Do you know where the magic sandwich is?" The beards floated. One of them began to revolve slowly. The Yetis watched it, but it turned right round and then paused where it had begun and floated there. Rah, rah, rah. Do you think that was a no? Rah. They decided to leave the beards alone and carried on up the stairs. Rah, rah, rah. Where are the faces that go with those beards? Rah, rah, rah. I dread to think. Great Aunt Honey raced up the stairs again. The Yeti followed. Pat, pat, pat. There were voices coming from up the stairs. Hello, do you like the beards? They never do anything. What's the point of them? Well, you don't do much.
I do more than them.
And look who's talking. You do the same as me. You flaming great hypocrite.
Wow.
Oh, it said something.
What is it?
A walking rug.
A sheep that stood on its hind legs.
Do you think it's what clouds are made of?
It's too grubby for a cloud. Look at it, filthy. And what's that stuck to its feet?
Looks like dried bogies to me.
How do you know what bogies are? You haven't got a nose.
They are not invisible to people without a nose.
Wow.
It said something again. The Yeti peered over the edge of the stair. There were two things floating in the air. They were red and white, flat on one side, raised up on the other with a hole. What they actually were, shoes, but the Yetis didn't own any shoes. The scared old creatures that live near them never had shoes like these.
Rah rah rah.
Rah. Oh look, there's another one.
It's even bigger and not quite as filthy.
It's uglier though, isn't it? Don't you think?
That one's got the fur missing off its ear.
But that one looks like a rocky face that got hit by a snowball.
Whoa!
Don't interrupt.
They must be snow leopards. Ooh. The smaller one's cross. Then the Yetis noticed the cave. There were several doorways around the walls with steps, some leading up and some leading down. Behind him, there were three more spiral staircases and more doorways with steps. Yes, there are lots of stairs around here, aren't there? I bet you'd like to know where they go.
Well, don't ask left. He doesn't know.
Yes, I do. I know more than you.
No, you don't. This continued for a while. The Yeti watched them calmly. Great Aunt Honey trotted off to look in the doorways and sniff the air. You can't tell anything from here.
There might be a smell. How do you know? You haven't got a nose.
The shoes carried on arguing. The Yeti ambled over for a closer look at them. The soles were white. The cloth upper was red, and the laces were white. They were very clean.
I am not the sandwich, so don't think I am, you big hairy snow leopard.
Wow. Great Aunt Honey trotted back. Now you've done it. They'll go away again.
Well, let it eat you then.
Leopards don't eat shoes. Well, I might know where the sandwich is.
You don't know. I do.
I think I do.
You can bear anything at all.
Rah, rah, rah.
Snow leopards are rude.
Rah, rah, rah.
Great Aunt Honey was becoming impatient. You might be one of those over there.
Wrong end of the cave entirely.
Well, the shoes spent some time arguing. The Yeti placidly watched. Great Aunt Honey went back to sniffing the doorway. Which was Yeti for, this one smells like it could be food. The shoes were ignoring them. The Yeti ambled over to his great aunt. Great Aunt Honey went first. She went through the doorway and bounced up the stairs and disappeared out of sight. Oh dear. The Yeti slowly went through the doorway and up the stairs. The shoes hadn't noticed them leaving. At the top of the stairs was the start of a passage, but there was no light ahead. The Yeti sighed and stepped forward into a very big hole in the ground. It was so deep, the bottom of it was in a different cave altogether. End of part 7.